Shalom and welcome to this edition of Revealing the Truth, where we cover the headlines, the heart lines, and biblical truth. I'm your host, the Reverend Rabbi Eric Walker. In this edition, we are going to take a journey with a man who has had a life that was memorialized in a nationwide way, something that directly impacted my life and impacted your life. His name is William J. Murray, and when he was just an innocent child, his mother used him as a tool in filing a lawsuit that ultimately led to the Supreme Court case that to decide the compulsory prayer and reading the Bible in public schools was unconstitutional. And he wrote a book, My Life Without God, kind of giving you the background of who he is. But today we're going to be talking to him about his new book, Utopian Road to Hell, Enslaving America and the World with Central Planning. We're talking about William J. Murray, who is now the chairman of the Religious Freedom Coalition in Washington. For more than three decades, he's been at the forefront of social conservatism. He has appeared on ABC, CBS, NBC, Fox News, authored hundreds of columns, appearing online and in print, the author of eight books. He continues to work for the rights of Christians in America and persecuted Christians around the world. William Murray, please join us. Welcome to Revealing the Truth.
Thank you. Great to be on with you today.
You have such an interesting story. And I think it's a re-release now of your Life Without God, you kind of take us on a journey 30 years back to how you were not raised in faith but came to faith.
Well, you know, this is it. My Life Without God is still in print. It's on its third publisher, believe it or not. It started out as a hardback book with the Nelson Company back in 1982, I believe. It went to Harvest House about a decade later in quality paper, and then it went to mass paper and was out for, but there's been just so much demand for the book that WND publishers picked it up and released it. And the book is My Life Without God. It really isn't a true autobiography because I'm 70 years old now, and right. The book sort of stops, right about the time I'm in my mid 30s. But basically, that book traces me being raised in an extreme dysfunctional family. And by the way, there's a movie about a almost fictionalized movie about to come out about my mother, Madeline Murray O'Hare, called the Most Hated Woman in America. It's called a Google movie, and by that I mean somebody wants to throw together a movie, they Google up facts, anything public that they can find in order to use and take things out of people's books, oftentimes different producers without permission, in order to cram something onto Netflix. So there's going to be that type of a movie about her, in which I'm sure, you know, she's going to be turned into a hero. The reality of this was that I was raised in a truly, truly, truly dysfunctional home back in the 60s, when there weren't as many dysfunctional homes as there are today, and it isn't as common. And I mean, dishes flying through the air, a constant profanity. My mother would lie when the truth would serve her better, simply because she was a pathological liar. There were alcohol problems in my home. My grandfather, who was glorified as a great steel contractor, was actually, you know, ran a roadhouse at one time, in which things of very ill repute went on, ran alcohol during Prohibition. So that is the kind of family history that I had. And out of that came, in that family, came a hatred for God. I'm not exactly sure where, and it might have been multi-generational, and I don't think it really did start with my mother. But it wasn't truly atheism. It was literally a hatred for the deity, a hatred for organized religion. And she was also so dysfunctional that she couldn't hold down a job. And I can run this through very briefly, but that inability to hold down a job led her to communism. A lot of people think that the communists recruit on the college campuses, and they don't. They recruit from back then and still today. The far, far left recruits from unemployment lines, generally trying to get the kind of people that couldn't hold down a job if they could get one. And she had a history of not being, even with a college education, she couldn't hold down a job for more than 2 or 3 months at a time. The longest job she ever had in her life was with the federal government, and they fired her after a year. If you can imagine somebody getting hired and then actually fired by the federal government, it's just basically unheard of. But that led her to Marxism, to communism, and in 1960 she actually tried to defect to the Soviet Union, and took me and my brother with her. That's what led to the prayer case, to take prayer out of the schools, and which I outline in My Life Without God. You know, the defection failed. The Soviets did not want her, told her to go back to the United States, work for the revolution in the United States. And in returning, she put me back late in schools. It was the first time she had ever been in a school with me. And she discovered the prayer in the Bible reading the morning that she took me back in to explain my absence. The result of that was her filing the lawsuit. She also wanted to get the Pledge of Allegiance out of the school. I could go on and on and on. She was associated with the pro-Castro group, Fair Play for Cuba committee. She had been the manager of the Communist Party bookstore, and yes, there was such a thing, and still is in a couple of cities, Chicago, New York, Baltimore. The Communist Party is not completely dead.
Right.
So that is the background that I came back out of. And being in that kind of a dysfunctional lifestyle led me to a dysfunctional lifestyle. And it wasn't that I revolted against atheism. It was that the Lord saved me out of the dysfunctional lifestyle.
Well, it's such an interesting story, background, iconic, something that was certainly considered by many an overreach of the Supreme Court, that this was not something that was in violation of the Constitution. And I think really began a series of judicial overreach that we're seeing today as we look at laws about marriage and many other decisions that are being rendered. So you grew up with this chaos around you. You somehow came out of it, would you say, unscathed, or would you say that...
No, I wouldn't. I mean, this stayed with me for until I was 33. I was saved at 33. I actually had the ability to hold down a job where my mother didn't, and I did quite well in the aviation industry, became a field manager, an airline manager. But, you know, many of the things that I had learned in that home, including the... the excessive use of alcohol, and also I went from one side to the other. When I started making a good living and saw how much the government took out of my paycheck, I went from being the communism that I was raised in, and I was far from innocent. I mean, I was raised in this communist ideology, and had the Marxist-Leninist study classes that I went to as a young person. I had a better understanding of communism by the time I was 13 or 14 than a lot of people did that were being raised in the Soviet Union. That kind of dysfunctional lifestyle, I took a lot of things out of it with me, having been taught by my mother that the most important three things in life were sex, booze, and food. And so that's the lifestyle that I lived. And when I moved away from the communism, I went totally in the other direction, to social Darwinism, to extreme libertarianism, which is basically the whole idea of laissez-faire capitalism. If somebody can't feed themselves, then they should die and get out of my way. Fortunately, when I came to accept the Lord, I understood that there was a middle ground between those two. There was between the government giving everything to everybody and between letting people die if they were hungry, that there was a compassion middle ground that right. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ set out for us.
Well, it's such an interesting journey that shaped an understanding that now has equipped you to kind of take a backwards view on the ideologies of utopia, of various forms of leadership in the world, how this Amos Svengali kind of leadership rises up and pulls people into it. And you saw it firsthand because you saw your mother drawn to it. You experienced it, you were exposed to it, and you saw, after you came to faith, the very dark side of it from a standpoint of deceit, deception, confusion, distortion, and self-serving attitudes of those that promoted such concepts.
I really don't think that people understand, I particularly in the conservative movement and within the church, the evangelical church, conservative Catholics, for the most part, they think, oh, these people are, they're just destructive, they just hate us, they just that. No, these people actually believe in what they're doing. They actually believe that a utopian state can exist. They have this idea that human beings can somehow be managed in order to, quote, control their selfish desires, and that somehow you can have this the very base philosophy, if I could sum it up in the words of Karl Marx, from each according to their ability. From each according to their ability, to each according to their need. In other words, everybody takes everything. They work for the state. They apply all their ability in order to throw everything into a giant pot. But then they only take out of that pot what they need. And to make sure they only take out it what they need, there's overseers to make sure that people only get what they need. Well, then, of course, the question is, what is need? And that is where the system falls apart, and you wind up with classes of people within it that have different levels of need, in which the leaders wind up living like Kim Jong-il in North Korea, with palaces. But it is it's magic thought. It really comes down to magic thought of creating in your mind or in some kind of a group psychology this imaginary utopia on earth. And in a way, it's a false Christian doctrine. They want to create on earth. They think they can create on earth, that man can create on earth what only God can create in heaven.
You know, it's interesting that you've identified something that to me is reminiscent of Adolf Hitler, that his commitment to his sin was greater than the body of Messiah's commitment was to the Lord. We see it in America today that the homosexual, gay, lesbian, transgender community's commitment to their sin is so strong that it's become the loudest voice in the nation. It deafens people. It overshadows the reality of 98% of the population. The 2% are so committed to this vision that they will run rampant over all other rights of citizens to advance their cause. And it is that commitment to that vision that they are so, like you said, it's not random. It is a vision, and it's a combination of an ideology and a belief system and in a right that must be exerted upon others. It must be there is no exception to it. They are people that will not accept anything outside of this very narrow view.
Well, you mentioned Adolf Hitler, and this is what I tried to make very, very clear in Utopian Road to Hell, is there are many people that they have this vision that communism is on one side of the scale, the far left side of the scale, and then on the far right side of the scale is fascism and the Hitler ideology, and that could not be further from the truth.
Right.
The reality is that it doesn't matter whether it is Joseph Stalin's Soviet Union or whether it was Adolf Hitler or Mussolini or whether it was Mao or Pol Pot, the concept was the same: to create an ideal society, a utopian society. For Adolf Hitler, it was an Aryan thousand-year Reich. For Joseph Stalin and Lenin and that whole group, it was going to be a utopian state that lasted forever. The odd thing is what happens when it doesn't work, and I detail this in my book. When it was obvious that the communism was failing in the Soviet Union, even after it had spread to Cuba and China and other places, what happened? It was people would try it somewhere else, and their logic would be the same. Oh, it didn't work in the Soviet Union, but it will work here. Well, then they try it in Cuba, and it doesn't work in Cuba. So somebody else says, well, it doesn't work in Cuba, but it'll work here. And the Chinese say, well, it doesn't work in Cuba, but it'll work here. And then we got to a situation like Cambodia and Pol Pot. And he said, well, the reason that they were not able to create this utopian society is because they had too many people that were infested with these bad ideas. So what we'll do is we'll simply kill everyone that could be infested with these ideas, and we'll start off with a primitive society, and from that primitive society we will be able to create our utopian dream. So he killed everybody that spoke a foreign language, and just virtually everybody that had a college education, all police officers, all army officers. In fact, they killed a lot of people just because they wore glasses, because they figured they must read a lot. They killed people that played musical instruments. I mean, they murdered a third of the population. There's a movie and a book called The Killing Fields of
right.
It. And it was off of one thing, and that was Pol Pot's dream, that he felt the reason that creating a perfect communist state has failed everywhere else is because they had too many of the bourgeois left around, and that to eliminate those. And oddly, that seems to be the solution every single time. The liberals, the far left, they depict themselves as, oh, we're so peaceful and we're so wonderful. We just saw that in Berkeley, how peaceful and wonderful they were in trampling on somebody else's free speech.
Right.
But the reality was, Stalin killed tens of millions of people. Mao killed tens of millions of people. Pol Pot killed millions of people. The prison camps of Romania, Bulgaria, the situation in a desperate situation in Hungary and in Poland, in Vietnam for some time before it became a friend of the United States, which still boggles my mind. The goal has always it always winds up being totalitarian. It always winds up with misery. And I would point this fact out that I pointed out in the book. Anybody can fact check me on this, because it's a very simple thing to do. More people died in the 20th century at the hands of their own governments, of atheist communist governments, of atheist-led governments, more people died at the hands of their own governments than died in all the wars, in all the history of mankind, including World War II. World War II had a fraction of the casualties of the number of people that Joseph Stalin killed. This was even Adolf Hitler's murder in the concentration camps of nearly 10 million people total, when all the Jews and dissidents and everybody else is added up. That was small comparison to the number of people that were killed in the Soviet Union. And we have to consider the fact that Hitler was also a utopian. He was not a Christian. He was not a Catholic, as many depict. And in fact, he created an occultist form of Christianity in Germany that worshipped ancestry and worshipped the continued Aryan race. In fact, he depicted actually the lost tribes as being Germanic.
Yes, absolutely. We're talking with William J. Murray, author of Utopian Road to Hell, Enslaving America and the World with Central Planning. From WND Books, William is the chairman of the Religious Freedom Coalition in Washington, D.C. Rich history, amazing story of coming to faith and on being from one side of the spectrum to the other, now that he's protecting Christian rights all over the world. We're talking about this utopian road to hell, this ideology that is permeating many countries around the world and actually is driving one of the agendas of a group in America who are looking to turn us into a socialist and even Marxist nation that will drive our country to the brink of destruction. When we return, we're going to dig into more of some of this story, Utopian Road to Hell, with William Murray, and we'll be right back.
Angela Waite, and I just finished my interview on Revealing the Truth with Rabbi Eric Walker. I hope that in some way you will be touched by my story and that you will receive the healing you so desperately desire. I would like to share my story with you and send you a personalized signed copy of my book, Bomb Pops, Blow Dryers, and Butterfly Kisses, for your tax-deductible gift of $25 or more to Igniting a Nation, Inc. I will personally send you my book along with a note of encouragement as you take this journey with me. You will not only be supporting the work of Igniting a Nation, but all the proceeds that I receive from book sales goes to support Ramsey's Rescue, which targets the physical and spiritual care of the little ones who have been abandoned. It is the goal of this ministry to provide food, clothing, education, medical, a safe and loving home, and hope. Please help support both ministries with your gift and make a difference in so many lives today. Send your check payable to Igniting a Nation, 2700 Corporate Drive, Suite 120, Birmingham, Alabama 35242. May the Lord bless you for your generosity and support.
This is the Reverend Rabbi Eric Walker, Executive Director of Igniting a Nation and host of Revealing the Truth, right here on the Igniting a Nation Broadcasting Network, inviting you to join me every Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday for our Prophecy in the News classes. Each week, I take the headlines from around the world that have a biblical connection and present them in a way that brings the news and the Bible to life. There are over 2,500 prophecies in the Bible, and there are so few classes available to see how they connect with world events. We cover everything from Islamic terrorism to the changing relationships between Russia, Turkey, Iran, Syria, and Israel. Prophecy is unfolding before our very eyes, and to many, it is complicated and hard to understand. In just 1 hour each week, you'll be given the tools and the biblical connection to world events. With so much going on, and so few reliable sources of news, I encourage you to join me every Monday night at 7 o'clock p.m. at St. Mark United Methodist Church in Northport, every Tuesday night at 7 p.m. at Beechwood Baptist Church in Mount Olive, and every Thursday night at 7 p.m. at Mountain Chapel United Methodist Church in Vestavia. If you want to make sense out of what's happened in the world around you, this is the class for you. All are welcome. Times and location addresses can be found on our website at ianbn.com. I hope to see you there. Shalom. Shalom and welcome back to Revealing the Truth, where we cover the headlines, the heartlines, and biblical truth. We're talking with William Murray, author of Utopian Road to Hell, Enslaving America and the World with Central Planning from WND and WND Books. It says on the back of the book, utopian dreamers are both deceived and deceitful. They'd fight for the people. Rhetoric may sound good at first, but history proves egalitarian governments destroy freedom, destroy creativity, and destroy human lives. In Utopian Road to Hell, William Murray, son of former atheist apologist Madeline Murray O'Hare, masterfully exposed the wide swath of destruction such deluded leaders have created throughout history and warns of the danger posed by today's power-obsessed utopians. He reveals that Marx and Hitler's socialist engineering had occult roots. Utopians Pol Pot, Vladimir Lenin, Joseph Stalin, Mao Zedong were responsible for the death of tens of millions of people. Margaret Sanger, Planned Parenthood founder, and Saul Alinsky's rebellious desire to be free from morality has led to a crumbling society and much more. He says to avoid continuing down the path of the utopian road to hell, Murray explores with readers the absolute necessity of reclaiming the freedoms of each individual and what that truly entails. William J. Murray, welcome back to the program.
Thank you very much.
Margaret Sanger, a name that so often talked about in the Planned Parenthood ranks, the Roe v. Wade debacle, and the birth of abortions, the leading cause of death in America. How was she indoctrinated? Where did her brainwashing come into play?
Well, there are several factors there. What I'd really like to focus on, though, is the almost fascist ideology that she wound up with, and the concept of eugenics, which is very much ignored in our society today when it comes to abortion. Probably many people do not know that over 90% of the abortion clinics in the United States are within walking distance of an African-American neighborhood. There are no abortion clinics out in white suburbs or predominantly Caucasian areas. And this is the real reason that Margaret Sanger founded Planned Parenthood. She believed that inferior people, black or white for that matter, needed to be done away with in order to help create this perfect society, much like Adolf Hitler saw us creating this Aryan super race through breeding. And again, it goes back to this utopian type of magic thought of turning humanity into something that it is not and never was, and at the same time taking away our freedom. I shouldn't go into it right now, but I'm going to bring up Friedrich von Hayek, because he was the Austrian, and I quote him extensively in the book in some areas. He was the an Austrian economist, an economic economist, and there's basically only two concepts of economy and society in the world. One is the French, and the other is the Austrian. That's it. We can claim there's an American and this and that and the other thing, but it isn't. For most of the time in the United States, we've practiced the Austrian, which is the freedom of the individual, to earn his money, to spend it why he wants to live in this bubble of liberty, and inside that bubble of liberty with consistent laws that are unchanging, so that the individual can know how to make a living, he can know what is legal tomorrow, he doesn't wake up one day and what he does is legal and wake up the next day and it is illegal. And that way he can have that sphere of freedom in order to function in and to create. People like Margaret Sanger and her concepts are basically to take that sphere away and to create a society in an image that they think will be best for all people. They actually believe down in their hearts that they can create a society. In Margaret Sanger's case, that they can create a society through eugenics and other individuals through indoctrination, that they can create a society in which basically we all hold hands and sing kumbaya and work for the benefit of the state.
But yet, all of this goes to ethnic cleansing. It goes to creating a superior race through selective elimination of all the people who would be qualified as lesser than the standard. And this is an un-Christian, un-Jewish, un-biblical thought that permeates society.
Well, it violates the basic tenet of a biblical truth in that we are all created equal in the eyes of God. We are not equal. No two human beings are equal to each other. They have different talents. They have different abilities. They have different defects. They're of different race. But in the eyes of God, people are equal. And by being equal in the eyes of God, their color does not matter, their ability does not matter. To God, somebody who is born with some type of a defect or handicap that overshadows their life is the same in the eyes of God as is a someone who is an Albert Einstein or a great athlete. And this concept doesn't work for those who want to create a utopia on Earth at all, because they cannot have a lot of those folks around them, and they particularly cannot have those that disagree with them. And just bringing up, and I know you want to touch other things that Margaret Sanger, but if we talk about just the safe spaces that we have today, where you've got people that they cannot talk to anybody that disagrees with them, and they have to have little rooms that they can retreat to, where they can play. We're talking about adults in a university. They're in their 20s, and they have to go retreat to a room with soft music and little stuffed animals to hold on to whenever there's something being said on the outside that they find offensive. These are the kind of people that when you create that kind of group, that they wind up becoming violent when they hear the views of others, because it becomes so repugnant to them, because they have been trained at virtually every level in our society not to deal with insults, not to deal with people of differing views. And so this creates a grave problem.
You know, it sounds like the indoctrination comes through academia. And we have absolutely no check whatsoever, because that would fall in the area of censorship. But what we're looking at on college campuses is nothing but this utopia that somebody is pitching to this next generation that's coming up, that says that if it's not your way, you can demand through any means possible that the world complies to your standards, because you have a standard of utopia where everything is perfectly aligned.
Right. Well, recently they've done surveys and found out the colleges and universities and political science are teaching not how to participate in government, but how to demonstrate against government. Which is interesting. But I'd like to point out, we always go with academia on this, but there are several other routes. Most people in the United States don't understand this. They hear Western democracy, Western democracy, Western democracy. They do not understand that in France, in Germany, in the United Kingdom, in Austria, in Hungary, in Greece, that much of what an American can say is against the law. And in fact, an American in those countries saying the wrong thing could very well be arrested and jailed or quickly escorted escorted out of the country. People go to jail in the UK just for saying that they're against Sharia law. We have seen high profile in the political arena. Look at this. The candidate for president of France, the last time she ran, she had charges filed against her for being a racist. The same thing happened in Austria. We see this with Geert Wilders up in Holland, where because he's become a powerful politician that speaks out and tells the truth, charges have been filed against him. The worst example I have ever seen is in Greece, where many years ago, several years ago, not that long ago, the political party that was against immigration, what they did is there was an immigrant killed in the street in some kind of a brawl. So the liberal government at the time said, aha, it is your speech that caused this. So they dissolved the party so they couldn't participate in the elections, and they arrested the leaders of the party for murder because this immigrant was killed probably in a robbery, and they used it as an excuse. We do not understand how little freedom there is in the West. And these utopians in the United States, they want to create the same situation that there is in France or Germany, where you can literally you can say very little without being arrested, and in some instances even criticizing the government and quote Western democracies can lead you to problems. We just saw that in Germany, where a poem about Aragon, the leader of Turkey, the Supreme Court of Germany banned the poem. And this is all, again, to create this concept of a utopian state where there are no differences between us. But in order to do that, you have to stop people from being different. You have to stop what they say.
It's interesting that we recently, probably within the last 4 or 5 months, saw legislation being proposed in New York that said that it would be a crime if you did not address a transgender by their new name.
That is a very, very good example. And also forcing individuals to accept the lifestyles of other people that they may disagree with. You know, I think polygamy is wrong. Forget about the gay lifestyle. I figure polygamy is wrong. We are going to wind up in a state eventually, because of the court actions that have existed, where polygamy has been legalized, and that will be something else that you're going to be forced to accept. So it is a sliding slope that we're on in the United States, very rapidly headed to, and I want to point out, it is right next door to our neighbors too. Take Canada, for example. How many Christian authors and TV personalities have been told that they cannot come to Canada and speak, or that their books can't be distributed, or their TV shows can't be shown in Canada? They're being censored because they don't follow the social liberal agenda of Canada.
Well, you're exactly right. This is why we chose the format that we did, was to be an internet on demand television show where we were not selling commercial time. Our time is not available for sale. This is run by our ministry and for the sole purpose of bringing out the truth, the biblical truth, without apology, to make sure that we cover the subjects. We were just on with Ben Kinslow in the previous segment talking about the deception being perpetrated on the African-American community in America by a Democratic agenda that has never served them well. It's been the Republicans all along that have been taken care of and legislating for the support for the civil rights, but Democratic presidents have taken credit for it. So there's this media issue. And I think that as we begin to examine these spheres of influence that drive people to a common understanding, if the only voice you hear, William, is the voice of this utopian agenda, if the media is fully engaged in this, and it's now becoming a worldwide experience that For instance, the Washington Post being owned by Jeff Bezos from Amazon, it becomes his blog under the guise of reporting, of true journalism. But we found that it's not true journalism. It is agenda journalism. It is for advancing the causes of unified, uniform thinking and determining for America what your offense is. And it's always slanted to the offended, to the disenfranchised, to the one who is...
Well, the one that they choose to be offended.
Yes, right.
But let's put it that way, because the reality is I'm offended by much of what they say and what they do. Nobody cares whether I'm offended or you're offended.
Right.
They choose the people that get to be offended by speech, and they get to choose who to shut up. One of the things that I made clear in Utopian Road to Hell that I really want to get across is that these people, whether it's Margaret Sanger, whether it's Barack Obama as an example, they actually believe in what they're doing. They believe that this thing can be done. I don't know how many people I've run into say, well, Obama just hated America, Nancy Pelosi just hates America. No. I mean, you can actually look at Nancy Pelosi, and you can listen to her speak, and you can tell that she has drunk some kind of Kool-Aid, that she actually believes that this kind of crazy society in which everybody is equal, everybody eats the same food, the same amount of food, they actually believe this, and it goes down to the nitty gritty of managing people's lives, of telling them, you know, you whether they can drink sweetened tea or can't drink whether they have to drink ice. When you get into a situation where somebody walks into a restaurant and they can only have 20 ounces of sweet tea, but they can have 60 ounces of unsweet tea, and that kind of shows the ridiculousness of the extent that they are willing to go in order to nip away at the freedoms of individuals in order to create this classless society, of which, of course, they'll be the rulers because they are intelligent enough to think it up. It's sort of an Animal Farm, the conclusion of Animal Farm, the book where when everybody goes to check all animals are equal, somebody has added all the animals are equal except for pigs.
Right. Do you find that socialism is the gateway drug to this utopian road to hell?
Not necessarily, because right now we see the social avenue going to it. The idea that we can create a social society with all kind of millionaires and billionaires like George Soros as an example. And we can create this perfect social society, which has an exception for these super wealthy people that share the same social agenda. In a way, with those people, I really think that what's going on is they think that they're buying their continued existence by going along with the social agenda, but that's a whole other matter. But I think right now that socialism, I think in a way it's a goal, but I don't even think that those participating in this right now understand that that is actually the direction that they're going in.
Well, Bernie Sanders certainly knows, and his following know what it's called and what it is all about.
But they're selling it in pieces. Let me give you an example. It is, we're going to excuse the student debt. Well, who pays for it? We're going to give free education. Well, who pays for it? Well, the government does. Well, where does that come from? Well, the money comes, we're going to tax the wealthy. Except you can't tax the wealthy enough to do everything that's promised, so eventually you have to take from everybody. I would point out, I think the root cause of the evil in America today, when it comes right down to it, if you want to trace it down, it didn't start with my mother, it started with Woodrow Wilson.
Mm-hmm.
Woodrow Wilson was kind of gave us the poison pill when he managed to get the Constitution amended in order to begin the federal income tax. At the time, They promised that no more than the top 2% of earners in the United States would ever pay income tax, that this was just a matter to get the wealthy to pay their fair share, and that nobody else would have to pay any income tax. Look where we're at today with that. And this is the kind of way that the Bernie Sanders is doing the same thing. He is making these promises that particularly young people buy because they're the beneficiaries of it, and nobody understands that eventually there's going to be a cost. And when people don't want to give up their rights and their property in order to pay for this, they're going to have to be forced to do it in some way, even by gunpoint or even by surrendering their lives.
Right. It makes total sense. You walk us through a great deal of detail about the past. Why aren't we learning from the past? What is it about America that causes us to refuse to look at historical patterns, trends, social, political, economic, and decide that we're going to refuse to learn from others and do it our way?
Perhaps the same way that Israel sees Saudi Arabia as an ally today. It is a refusal to accept the past, the idea that I am so intelligent, I am so bright, that I can do this without making the same mistakes that somebody made mistakes before, but now we're not going to make it. And the other thing is that we're bought off. It is just like the printing of the trillions and trillions and trillions of dollars that we have right now. Basically, the Treasury issues notes that are IOUs, and the IOU says, "I owe you nothing." And we're living in this dream society right now that is just based on printing worthless paper money and handing it out. And the utopians think that if you read the utopian economists and those on the left, they say, well, this works. You can just keep printing money and give it to people. People don't even have to work. We can give everybody in the country just an income, whether they work or not, and they'll have plenty of money to buy stuff, and everybody is going to be happy. And with no knowledge that there is an economic base, that you have to have farming, manufacturing, and mining as the base. Wealth has to be created somewhere, which I go into in Utopian Road to Hell as well. And you know, we're the socialist dream world that we have today is actually a government that just prints and gives away money for free, that isn't going to work either.
Well, you're exactly correct. We've been talking with William J. Murray, author of Utopian Road to Hell, Enslaving America and the World with Central Planning. He cautions America to avoid continuing down the path of the Utopian Road to Hell by showing us the necessity of reclaiming the freedoms of each individual and what that truly entails, going all the way back to our founding fathers, going back to the very foundation of America, and restoring for America a clear path of this republic. And our path right now is a divided path, and we must unify to avoid this advancement, this advancing louder cry for this uniformity and collective thinking of this utopian road to hell. William Murray, thank you so much for being with us. It has been a delight to get to know you. I strongly encourage our audience to go to our books and media page, order this, educate yourself, inform yourself. Make it so that you can recognize what's happening in the world as the media is shouting louder, as these groups in California are shouting louder, as leaders in our country are shouting louder. Make sure you recognize and filter what this is telling you through this kind of lens so that you're here, you're clear on what you're hearing. William Murray, thank you so much for being with us, and we hope to see you again soon.
Thank you, and God bless.
God bless you. Thank you.